y'all.
President Ronald Reagan once said, freedom is never more than one generation away from extinction. That statement is more true now than ever before.
Biblical principles are what produce freedom in society, but you won't have biblical principles in society in which you don't have citizens with a biblical worldview.
The truth of the matter is most Americans don't have a biblical worldview, which means that they have to draw on, or they've chosen to draw on, other worldviews that are available to them.
The further we move away from biblical principles, the further we move away from liberty and freedom.
Remember in the Old Testament, after the scripture had been hidden for so long and it was brought out and it was read before the people?
Right.
The people wept with joy.
That's right.
Because there's freedom.
I found over the years that the only really reliable matrix to reality is the biblical blueprint.
We've relegated to say, look, politics is dirty. That's what pastors say. Politics is dirty. I don't do politics. Well, the church is dirty. What's your point?
There's so many people today that are educated at institutions where they come out as secular humanists.
Yeah.
And so there's no fear of God.
If you're a Christian, a person of faith, you must care about what's happening in our culture. You must get involved in voting.
No, the Constitution is so unique. It is the only constitution that actually limits government.
So in other words, if you put bad people into a broken structure, you're going to get bad results. If you have a bad system, you elect good people, they go into a bad system, you're still going to get a bad result.
And the founders knew this nation was already very diverse. Federalism allows that diversity to flourish.
And you begin to love what God loves and hate what he hates in the scriptures because your heart is lining up with the heart of God because of the gospel.
It is astounding to me how many people in America have been indoctrinated into a condition of complete ignorance.
I think biblical citizenship as a Christian would be stewardship, that God has given us this republic to be stewards over.
In terms of actually having a biblical perspective on things, even in terms of believing that the Bible is a trustworthy document to give them guidance for their future, most Americans are not in that place.
As people are experiencing tyranny, they're asking why, what has happened? And there's just this feeling of being lost right now and not knowing where to turn. And you just gave us the foundation. This is truth.
Well, good morning. Welcome to Palm Sunday here at Wooster Nazarene. My name is Andrew. We are so glad that you are here today with us in the room or joining us online. It's going to be a great day together. That video is about a class that Rick Geithian is teaching starting in 2 weeks called Biblical Citizenship. There's another reminder about it in the weekly update that we'll get to in a couple minutes. But Rick and his wife are out at the table this morning. If you have questions about how you can sign up for that class or what the class is all about, that was a little insight to what the material covers. So that's why we showed that to you this morning. Wanted to share with you an Outlinks moment, a celebration of your generosity, how it's blessing other people. In the Church of the Nazarene, we have these things called districts, and we are part of the North Central Ohio District of the Church of the Nazarene. It makes up about 60 churches, and one of those churches is our Jefferson Church, where Pastor Curtis and Mandy Cecil are pastoring. And about 2 weeks ago, their oldest daughter, Dakota, she was on her way back to school and was in a horrific car accident. And Dakota has been in a medically induced coma for the last 2 weeks, waiting for brain swelling to go down so that they can do surgery on a broken femur and some facial bones and just a lot of other healing that needs to happen. And so we've been praying about this as a staff. Maybe some of you have known about it. But they have a lot of need right now, especially financial, for medical bills and being there at hotel, because this happened over in Indiana or Illinois, one of the two. And so they just have a lot of extra expenses. And so we as a church were able to give $1,500 to them out of Outlinks to bless them in this time where they have so many things going on and they're in the middle of this trauma with their daughter. So thank you for your generosity in helping make that happen. There's a lot of different things that we get to support with Outlinks, but we know that investing in people and helping in times of need is something that we'll never regret. So we're thankful that we were able to be a part of that. And so in that kind of note and vein, we're actually going to start with prayer this morning. We are going to pray for Dakota. We'll pray as a church family, as we do every week. But I would invite you, if you want to come, if you want to kneel, if you want to stand, let's enter into prayer this morning. We will stand in the gap for Dakota, and we will pray together as a family. So let's do that this morning as we start. Well, Father, this morning, we come before you with grateful and thankful hearts. We're reminded on this Palm Sunday the triumphant entry that you made into Jerusalem, the King coming. We're so thankful, Lord, the path as we walk through this holy week of you going to the cross, to the grave, and rising in the resurrection and victory. So we thank you for the significance of this holy week and even of this Palm Sunday. And we never want to take it for granted, what you did on the cross for each one of us, that you poured out your life so that we could be set free from our sin, from ourselves, and that in that freedom, we experience eternal life with you. And so we thank you for the cross. We thank you, Jesus, for your blood applied. When we surrender, when we say yes to you, and we enter into a relationship with you, we ask you to be our Savior and our Lord. So that's our heart's position this morning, a position of humility, of going palms up, of surrendering to you today. We give ourselves to you. And our prayer this morning is, come, Holy Spirit, be in this place. We thank you that you live inside of us, that you're moving and active. And I pray, Lord, this morning that you would be drawing us forward deeper into your love, deeper into your truth. That even this morning, God, there would be some that say, it's time for me to surrender. It's time for me to give up. Today is my day to say yes to Jesus. So we invite those opportunities here this morning, Lord. Lord, as we know, there are so many things going on in our church family, diagnoses, the loss of a family member, even in the last day, so many difficult struggles. And so we bring those to you, Lord. We lay those things at your feet. We ask you that you would be moving and working in each situation. And this morning, as a church family, we come together in agreement and we pray for Dakota. Lord, you know every detail of the accident, of the trauma, of the brain swelling, the broken bones. God, we pray for your healing power to continue to be released on her body, her mind, her spirit. Lord, there's so many stories even already of how you've been moving and working in that situation. And so we pray that you would be doing all the more. We pray for complete healing, God. We pray that the swelling numbers in her brain would come down so that they can even do the procedures that they need to do. We pray for Pastor Curtis and Mandy, that you would draw close to them. They have a really big family with many kids and a church and all the things. And I just pray, Lord, that you would give them an extra measure of strength and endurance, wisdom for decisions that need to be made, But more than any of that, Lord, I pray that they would have an overwhelming sense of your peace that only you can provide. So we put that whole situation in your hands this morning, Lord. We entrust it to you. And I'm confident, Lord, that you will continue to be faithful. We thank you, God, for the good things that you're doing in and among us. There are so many good things. And this morning, we just point and praise to you. It has nothing to do with us and everything to do with your goodness and your faithfulness in our lives. And as we do that, Lord, it's an honor, really a privilege that we get to return the tithe to you and then give above and beyond that to things like Outlinks, the More to Come campaign, whatever it is that we're giving to this morning, God, I pray that it would be coming from cheerful hearts and thankful hearts. And we have confidence, Lord, that as a church, our generosity is impacting lives like the Cecil family, God. Not that we're just so great, it's just a blessing to be a part of blessing your people. So I pray that you continue to show us how we can be faithful in our tithing and our generosity above and beyond that, Lord. And so this morning, Father, as we gather in this place, we thank you for your presence here in our midst. We invite you to move, to transform, to draw us closer to you this morning. We ask and we pray all of these things in the mighty name of Jesus. And everybody said, amen. As the ushers are coming, I will invite you to turn your eyes to the screen for the weekly update.
Hey there, Wooster Naz, Pastor Joel here with your weekly update. So let's get right to it. So we have three classes coming up to make you aware of. First, our next basics class will be on Saturday, April 6th. This class is great if you're new to your faith in Jesus, if you're new to the church, if you just want to revisit the basics of our faith, maybe who we are at Wooster Naz, or how you can be part of the team. The second class to mention is the Biblical Citizenship class. Being biblical citizens requires a knowledge of biblical principles and how to apply them to the world around us. Join us for this 8-week class to learn how we can be a part of the catalyst for restoring biblical values in our neighborhoods, state, and nation. And thirdly, we want to mention Alpha. Alpha is an 11-week series of group conversations that explore the basics of the Christian faith in a friendly and safe environment. Come connect with new people, have a free dinner, and watch a video episode on a question about faith, then get to share your thoughts and hear from others. And if you don't believe me that Alpha is impactful, listen to one of my friends who's been through it recently.
I'm not very familiar with the understanding of the Bible. A lot of questions around it and a lot of misunderstanding around it. And I really wanted to understand the Word of God and the understanding of the Bible. And Alpha class brings that into a whole different format of breaking it down for you and understanding the Bible. Being in the group setting really helps a perspective on that you don't have to know everything and you can learn from other people, and it's okay to be from other walks of life, and don't matter what color, shape, size, form, or religion you are, for any walk of life that you come from, that you get a very good understanding from the Alpha class from a different group of people. And it's not judged. I would encourage anybody that wants to come to the Alpha class, please don't hold back. Come as you are. Come with plenty of questions. Come for Andrew's joke of the day, and or the evening, I guess the classes are, and come hungry, because they do feed you. Even if you do know more about the Bible, come also, because you're gonna help those people that are seeking the hunger and the word for God and help them understand better. Those are the people that we need to help people like me. So it's been a very great eye-opener and understanding more of the Bible.
Thanks so much, Tammy. And finally, the IF Gathering 2024 is a great day for women to experience Jesus. In this one-day video-based event, Nationally known speakers will help ladies remember his character, power, mystery, love, and delight. Women from all walks of life come together to worship, fellowship, eat, and have life-giving table conversation. And you can find all the details and register for it at WoosterNaz.org/events. There are so many things going on around here. We've got Too Good to Be Through that's happening on April 13th, and then baptisms on April 21st. But to find out about everything that's happening around here and all the details that you need, check out our website and go to the events tab. And if you're new to us today, stop by the Connect area on your way out and give us a chance to get to know you. Or if you're online, go to the website and click on the I'm New tab and fill out the Connect card. Because around here, we believe everything rises and falls on relationships. Relationship with the Lord and with each other. God bless, church, and have a great day.
by a love that hung on a cross. It's the gospel of Jesus that rescues us. Come on, sing it again. I've been saved by a love that hung on a cross. It's the gospel of Jesus that rescues us. Alone in my sorrow and dead in my sin, lost without hope with no place to begin. Your love made a way to let mercy come in. When death was arrested and my life began, ash was redeemed, only beauty remained. My orphan heart was given a name. My mourning grew quiet, my fear rose to dance. When death was arrested and my life began, oh, your grace so free washes over me. You have made me new, now life begins with you. Released from my chains, I'm a prisoner no more. My shame was a ransom. My dad and he called me his friend. When death was arrested, my life began. Oh, your grace so free washes over. Rejoiced as though heaven had lost. But then Jesus arose and I freedom in him. When death was arrested, my life began. That's when death was arrested, my life began. to forget the day your love broke through to make a way for hope to rise within my heart again. You freely pay the highest price. Suffering, you traded blood for me. My heart will sing the deepest praise. My lips rejoice, my hands will raise for the death that brought me into life. All for love, my Jesus. You freely paid the highest price. Suffering, you traded blood for me. My heart will sing the deepest praise. My lips rejoice, my hands will raise for the death that brought me.
Inside.
If it wasn't for Jesus, and what would I have become if it wasn't for Jesus?
To you, God of the redeemed. Hallelujah.
your grace, so free, washes over me. You have made new, now life begins with you. It's your endless love pouring out on us. You have made us new, now life begins with you.
This is my story. Sing it out. This is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story. This is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Thank you, team. Thank you so much. Appreciate it. Don't forget, what's Friday night? What's Friday night? Invite. By the way, we had a men's gathering breakfast yesterday morning. I think there were at least 70 in that room. Love the fellowship being together. And the key is, the word for the year is just invite. I've said it before, I'll say it again and again and again. That's what I do. If you invite somebody to come with you, 90% of people will say yes. That includes church, a good Friday night of worship, whatever. And just in the invitation, you may be introducing them to Jesus. Huh? Whether it's on their grid or not, and I would encourage you to do that. Keep inviting. So we're looking forward to that. So 7:15 on Friday night, let's fill this place, and we're going to do communion together. The trays will be passed, bread and juice. We're going to do that collectively, but it's going to be a wonderful night. So this leads into, as Pastor Andrew prayed, Holy Week, Palm Sunday, of course, and it starts and ends with a bang, so to speak, but in between is pretty rough. Agreed? So I want to talk about that. Because we know we're pointing to the resurrection, as I said yesterday in the first of the series, now the second Easter impact. The resurrection of Jesus changed everything, and we're going to hone in on that forever. Because it changes people forever. And it's not just past tense, but it's changes, and it's changing people right now. And so we're going to look about the events, how it impacted people. And I want us to come to the conclusion that it's not just the Bible we look to and point to for Easter people, but we need to be Easter people as well. That's the direction we're going. So I like to call the Easter-impacted, living, transformed Easter people. That's who we is in Jesus. So, this is Holy Week. We are remembering and mourning the temporary death of Jesus that did permanent work. Got it? The good news is that we know from this side of the cross, he didn't stay dead. Is anybody glad about that? He did not stay dead. So, we're mourning this week. But we're also celebrating the final outcome, because we believe, as someone has said years ago, Sunday's coming. But here's what I want us to focus on. What an emotional week it was, and it is. Again, from this side of the cross, we don't think
And we don't empathize, I think, many times with what the disciples were going through and the followers of Jesus and the despair that they must have found, thought in their mind and heart. Because they, again, they did not, even though Jesus gave them clues, they did not have a hint that Sunday was coming. I mean, they thought it was over. So think about that. But in this week, God reversed what the enemy intended and accomplished his own purposes. So I hope in this message we'll see that it was our sin and it was our brokenness that put Jesus on the cross collectively. The only solution was the Son of God for our sin. The only solution was the Son of God, Jesus, dying, paying the price. Jesus paid it all. We are so grateful that God loved us so much, so grateful that Jesus was willing to die. Listen, he didn't just die for someone else. You and I, we need to own it. He died for me and he died for you. He died for us. We need to embrace that truth. So here it is. I'll sum it up again. We should be sad, if you will. This is a sad to glad week, glad to sad to glad week. We should be sad or broken because our sins were so great. Jesus had to die. There was no other way. But we should rejoice or be glad because Jesus willingly died to pay for our forgiveness of sins provisionally. All we have to do is to receive it, to embrace it. But I'll say it again. This was the only thing that could save us because we couldn't save ourselves. And we still can't, and we still can't fix ourselves. Only Jesus can. I was taking just a snippet from Hebrews 12. I had three verses there, but the middle says, because of the joy, this is Jesus, because of the joy awaiting him, he endured the cross, disregarding its shame, and now he's seated in the high places with God. Wow. Because of the joy awaiting. Did you know that we're a part of that joy? Huh? As Jesus lovers and Jesus followers, those who have said yes to him, we're a part of that joy. So when did everything change? Everything changed forever in a moment on the cross when Jesus died. That's what the scriptures indicate. That wasn't the end of the story, but that's when everything changed, and I want to talk about those changes. So today we'll look at the story, but we'll also look at the outcome. So I direct your attention to Matthew 27, and I'll just read a little bit of that. I'm going to read verse 50. It says, then Jesus shouted out again, and he released his spirit. He died. At that moment, do you see that word? At that moment, the curtain in the sanctuary of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook and rocks split apart, and you can read on to see what happened. Wow. The curtain that had separated God and man, where only someone could go once a year, was forever torn, and we have now direct access to him. That happened in a moment at the cross. But the deal is, it's not just what happened there. We must believe and we must receive it as truth. The disciples were an emotional mess that week, and the followers of Jesus, an emotional mess. I think of the things that we get troubled over in this life. At our home this week, the power and the internet went down in the middle of the night. And somewhere, it was 5 hours or so, I don't know, but sometime during the night, the internet, the power came back on, but the internet didn't. And oh my, what a loss. I didn't realize the next day how many things I did that depended on the internet. Turns out that I guess the wind blew, tree fell, and on some power lines and out towards 250, I think, and some poles went down, and that impacted many people. And I thought about that. I thought about how one event, it seems so trivial, but one event of a tree blowing down on a power line, I think they told us that affected over 600 homes in an instant. Our lives, we're so dependent on so many things, make us so vulnerable. And oftentimes one event messes things up for a lot of people, like Adam and Eve sinned. But we're headed toward the completion, the outcome, where one event changed everything, and that includes the cross today. So I'm trying to empathize with the followers of Jesus, those who pinned everything, their hopes on him. Devotions this morning, the nets were crowded. They were so amazed at Jesus' miracles that they left everything and they followed him. I mean, they gave everything up. But the result of an event like this can mean loss, and we must grieve our losses. And this is true. This is a principle here, life principle. One of the most insensitive things that anybody can say is, are you over it? Are you over your loss yet? When we experience significant loss, we don't just get over it. Does anybody know that to be true? I think Dixie found this quote for me, and it wasn't referenced and sourced, but I loved it. I've edited a little bit of it. It says this, think about this loss, and I want us to think in terms of the disciples particularly. But grief never ends, but it changes. It's not a passage, not a fixed point, not a destination, a place to stay. Grief is not a sign of weakness, nor a lack of faith, but grief is the price of love. So the disciples, the followers of Jesus, were so close. They were so deeply grieved. Why? Because they loved him so much. They pinned their hopes on him. So please know this. The Easter people surrounding the death and resurrection of Jesus took on a huge emotional hit, impact. And I want to tell you, emotional hits, good and bad and in between, they impact us. And as you get older and older, you realize that your emotional resources are drained. This was a draining time for them. They took that during Easter week. They suffered a great, great loss, and at the time did not have hope. Don't minimize it. I'll say it again. They didn't know when Jesus was on the cross and put in the grave, they didn't know that Sunday was coming. So today I want to talk to you about three simple things. And for this subtitle, just everything changed. So I want to tell you in this order, we're going to talk about the past changed. We're going to talk about the future changed in this order. And finally, the present is changing. Because I don't like it to be past tense alone, because in a relationship with Jesus, in a life-giving relationship, how do you know that you're not done growing and done changing? He's growing you. He's changing you. And that's the exciting thing about it. I don't care where you are, how long you've been a follower of Jesus. If you're not yet, I mean, he has a growth plan for you. So let's talk about the first thing, the past changed. Now, I've never particularly been a fan of time travel stories, and time travel kind of goes both ways, doesn't it? Some people travel into the future, and some people travel into the past, but for this story, when someone leaves the present, they go back to the past to make some strategic change. And how many of you know that if you go back in your past or somebody's past, you make a strategic change, how many of you know that greatly impacts the future? Would you agree? There's some things that we would like to go back and change, and if we could, it would kind of change some of the circumstances that we're in now. But that change in the time travel has a huge impact on their future, and so really back to the future is entirely appropriate, isn't it? Huh? But we can't do it, can we? We can't go back to the past, can we? But I know someone who can. His name is Jesus. Did you hear me? He can go back to a broken past, and he can make it as if it never happened, even though it really did. And that's what this week is all about. When by faith we choose to believe and accept, receive and accept what Jesus did on the cross, our past is forever changed, no matter what. It's possible just because he died, for sure, but it's also because next week we'll celebrate the fact that he is the living Lord. And as you touch him with your childlike faith, it extends and saturates not only your present, but the past, no matter what. Some of you are so stuck there in the past. And if you're a child of God, and if the blood has covered your sins, you're grieving over something that God doesn't even remember because of Jesus. No matter what. Some of us struggle with that. No matter what, that includes you. That's not for somebody else. That's for you and that's for me. God accepts the payment of Jesus on behalf of any and all our sin. Do you believe that? We believe it many times for others and can generously, distribute it, but it's true for you and it's true for me. Isaiah 53:6 alludes to it. It says, just part of it, the end part, it says, we've gone astray our own way, and that's what sin really is, doing it ourselves on the throne, me, myself, and I. That's the unholy trinity that I referred to last week. And the Lord has laid on him, Jesus, the iniquity of us all. He didn't lay it on you, he laid it on him. As recorded in our passage of Matthew that I just read briefly, this event literally and figuratively rocked the world. I mean, there was an earthquake, you know, unbelievable things happened. Dead bodies came to life and they appeared to many people in the city, it goes on to say in that passage. But I want you to know this, Jesus was sinless and we were sinful. Sin hyphen full, F-U-L-L. Listen, here's the story of this week. He died for what we did wrong. Wow. That's why we'll do communion. That's why Jesus said, do this in remembrance of me. He died for what we did wrong. I can hear somebody go, that's not fair. Exactly, that's grace. That's mercy. When something negative happens, it seems people are always looking for a scapegoat, someone to blame. I've told you before, you watch a pro football game and these huge linemen that weigh in over 300 pounds, when there's an infraction, they stand there pointing at each other. I go, isn't that a life principle? We're always looking for somebody to blame. Let's launch an investigation that takes years and comes to no conclusion. We got to find out whose fault it is. And I always go, then what? The Jews were pushing for the death of Jesus, for sure. The Romans were definitely on board, and Pilate allowed it. He washed his hands symbolically to try to distance himself from the death of Jesus. They were players in the story, but I'm coming back to this. It was our sin, your sin, my sin. That's what caused the death of Jesus. We killed Jesus. The sin of all man was put upon him. And quite frankly, I think that's what killed him. I mean, we know about the torture, the suffocation, and we know about the nails and the thrust in the side. We know all those things, but I believe it was our sin that crushed his heart and spirit. But he joyfully, the Bible says again in Hebrews, endured the cross. Go back to what I read last week in Colossians 2:13. You were dead because of your sins and because your sinful nature was not yet cut away. Not yet. I like that. I circle words like that. Not yet. Then God made you alive with Christ, for he forgave all of your sins. What's the key? When you ask, when you embrace what he did. He canceled the record of the charges against us and took it away. How? By nailing it to the cross. I was looking for it. Listen. You simply can't make this up. This is not a fictional writing. I jotted that it's too God not to be true. I didn't say too good. I said too God. It's too God not to be true. The record against us that we deserve, we're convicted by our own conscience and by God's conscience and by God's unchanging word. I mean, we know we've sinned. We knew better, but we did it anyway. We know we've done something wrong because God planted that conscience that can be seared, but still he's planted that conscience, and our own conscience accuses us. The word of God speaks to our heart. And who among us hasn't violated most of the Ten Commandments at one time or another in your life? Think about it. Read them again. In the Old Testament and in the New Testament law and the New Testament grace, the Bible clearly reveals the sin in our lives because it's got to be revealed before it can be dealt with. We got to own it before it can be dealt with. Ezekiel 18:20, parts A and C. The person who sins is the one who will die. Wicked people will be punished for their own wickedness. Romans 6:23, for the wages, there's more, but we'll use this. The wages of sin is what? Death, which is eternal separation from God. This is precisely why Jesus died on the cross. We were all absolutely over our heads in debt, big time. It's the only way our debt of sin could be paid in full. The record of our sin was nailed to the cross. Could we just say that Jesus nailed it? Once and for all, provisionally. He nailed it. Jesus nailed it. What? Your sin, my sin, our sin. It used to be a common practice, even in America, that when someone didn't have the money to pay, they didn't put it on a plastic card. They offered an IOU. Has anybody ever heard of an IOU? And basically that meant they went toe-to-toe, looked somebody in the eye, gave their word, shook their hand, and said, I'm good for it. You can count on me. I promise to repay you. Hopefully most of those IOUs were paid. I've heard horror stories, but I've heard good stories as well, and I'll assume the best. But what I'm thinking in this message today as we approach Holy Week is that I think this sometimes is what we try to do with God. We know we can't pay, we can't make up for our sins, so we offer him an IOU and pledge to pay it off by recording and remembering our good deeds and best self-help efforts. Come on. I've heard a couple stories this week, but I'm just thinking, for example, Pastor Andrew mentioned Dakota and the horrific accident where she lost control, went across the median, and ran into a semi head-on. Critical, critical. And literally, the Lord spared her life. It's amazing because there was a couple of emergency-type people, but one big, the way I understand it was reported to me, one big strapping guy that had, he was a military medic, if I'm not mistaken. And I think he had recently had some kind of a shoulder or arm surgery, and disregarding that, he pulled her out of that wreckage, and he ministered to her and literally preserved her life in that moment. And what a heroic thing. And my understanding is that it tore everything out that he had surgically repaired, and he has to have it done again. And we look at that. That was an act of heroism, wasn't it? But just for example, that's not going to get him into heaven. Do you understand that? Because sometimes we think, well, that's a really good thing, so that must make up for all kind of sin I've done because I did this good heroic thing. But that's not it. It's all about God's grace. Do you understand that? Nothing good that we have done. We can never earn it. We can never be good enough because our debt load is too great. The interest is compounding so much, we can make a minimum payment, but we can never pay it all back. And God knew that. So he sent Jesus. We've chosen to separate ourselves from him. We didn't choose original sin, but that's human nature, and this is why sin is so rampant in our world. Fallenness and brokenness opened the door and invited it into our world, into our lives, into our homes, into our relationships. But here's what God has done through Jesus. He had a plan to redeem all things to himself that we'd done wrong. It was made possible. It happened when Jesus died on the cross, when he breathed his last, the sacrifice was complete, just like that. 2:14 again of Colossians, he canceled the record of charges against us and took it away. By how? Nailing it to the cross. He nailed it. A couple of thoughts for the flyleaf of your minds. In God's sight, Jesus didn't just die for you, though he did. He died as though he were you and me. Wow. Follow me. He was treated as we deserve to be treated so God could treat us like Jesus deserves. I'm not sure you're getting it. Oh, my lands. Once we accept that free offer that was so costly, every wrong we've ever done is forgiven. God doesn't even see the things that we wish we could forget because the past is completely altered and changed forever. Does anybody believe that? How about in the grandstand? That's our hope today. And Romans 6:33 gives this declaration. Now, who dares accuse us whom God has chosen for his own? No one, for God himself has given us right standing with himself. How? Through the cross, Jesus nailed it, our sin. Wow. Under the blood, white as snow, removed as far as the east is from the west, buried in the sea of God's forgetfulness, never to be remembered again. So I think the word's kind of telling us, if God doesn't dwell on our forgiven past, we need to stop dwelling on it as well. Right. Don't go past tense and don't say, my life is over, it's ruined, this. No, there's hope. What's our response? We can accept this loving forgiveness, lean into it, live into it, and become radiant testimonies of living transformed. That means we're not done yet, but if you follow me, I've just got news for you. I'm following Christ because his powerful love can't be stopped. The Passion Translation, there's all kinds of translations. This is a newer one from Colossians 2. He erased it all, our sins, our stained soul. He deleted, I love that, he deleted it all, and they cannot be retrieved. There's a lot of things you can delete, but it's not truly deleted. I mean, somebody somewhere can find it, but what he did, he deleted it all, our sin, and those sins cannot be retrieved. Not by you or anybody else. And I've got news for you. When you mess up or if you sin beyond that point of forgiveness, all the forgiven sins don't come back. They don't come back. You just have to deal with what you got. You get up and you receive grace and forgiveness and you go on. Somebody needs to hear that. You don't go back to the start and go over again. You get up from where you are and you go on. Once your sin is forgiven. It's gone forever. Could somebody please say forever? I know some of you are receiving that, but are you believing it deep in your heart? His blood washes away all our sin. And from that point on, it's just as if it never happened. I'm talking about the past being changed. It's not you and me. It's not our good works. It's all Jesus. No other way for us to be saved. I'll say it again. Jesus paid it all once for all. You've heard this, Pastor White, because that's what this week is about. It's not about how many times we've heard it. It's whether or not we've responded. There's no other way for us to be saved. The story of the cross isn't about bad people becoming good. It's about dead people becoming Easter people. We were dead in our sins, cut off. This is only because the author of life was willing to die and exchange his life for our life. Nothing like it. It's too God not to be true. The second thing is the future's changed. When something happens and the past has changed, something, the future is completely different. Our future, because of Jesus, is completely opened up to the possibilities of his grace. And we start walking and living in resurrection power. And that's why I read so often Philippians 2:13 that says, for God now, as children of God, he's working in you and me, giving you the desire and the power to do what pleases him. Is anybody glad about that? We engage our free will, and he gives us the desire and power to do action, but to live in a way that pleases him, no matter what everybody else is doing. Jesus came out of the grave physically. He continued for a time to walk and live on this earth, and he kept showing up to his followers in a variety of ways. Colossians 1:20 says, and through Christ, God has brought all things back to himself again. Things on earth and things in heaven, God made peace through the blood of Christ's death on the cross. And sometimes that can be confusing, saying what he's brought all things back to himself. What a mess. But I think there's so many theologians, I've heard this all through schooling, the theologians call this the already but the not yet moment. I mean, he's already done the work, but we're not seeing the fruit of it because the Bible says that he is patient, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. Do we still believe that? God's not being slow. He's being patient. Doesn't appear that he's brought things all to himself. What a mess our world is in, but God is lovingly patient. He wants more to be saved before the culmination of human history. The work's been done, but it's not over. The work's been done, but it's not over. It's not over because some of you have never said yes to Jesus within the sound of my voice in this room online. That's why it's not over. He's waiting on you to say yes. He continues to unfold his amazing mercy and grace every single day. Because of the death of Jesus on the cross, in that moment, there's the promise of life after death. And death is simply being with Jesus, however you want to theologize it, between here and heaven. I mean, it's being in the presence of Jesus. This is not all there is. This is not all there is. This is our hope. His truth ought to bring peace into every life circumstance. Calm comes regardless of the storm. When we settle into the loving arms of God's grace, it applies to every age and every stage of life. But you've got to embrace it. You've got to receive it by your free choice. One day in the sweet by and by, this world will be a totally new version of itself, and a world is it meant to be without sin and anything that defiles and subverts the will of God. But in the meantime, we hold on to this hope and promise in Philippians 3:20. But we are citizens of heaven. That's code, I am a child of God. That's what makes us a citizen of heaven, starting right now, not just in the sweet by and by, where the Lord Jesus Christ lives. And we are eagerly waiting for him to return as Savior. That's what he's really going to turn to set everything right. He will take our weak mortal bodies and change them into glorious bodies like his own, using the same power with which he will bring everything under his control. I'm hopeful, are you? That goes against the grain of all the news and all the stuff of our culture. God's sovereign. To me, as I read this, I'm thinking again, we don't need to fear death, but we do need to prepare for it. How do you prepare for death? By coming into a life-giving, life-changing, transforming relationship with Jesus Christ. By receiving, accepting, believing what he did on the cross. You'll never get over it. That's what we're talking about today, this hope and a future here and there. Because Jesus shed his blood on the cross, we have the promise of life after death. What an exchange. Eternal life in the place of eternal death and separation from God. I think somebody ought to be getting excited about this. This is a great exchange. Eternally, we were sentenced, we were on death row, and he gave us eternal life by simply trusting in what's factually true and saying, yes, I believe, I agree. But you got to do it. You got to make that step. Nobody can do it for you. Nobody can make it for you. Don't be afraid. The Bible says we're in Psalm 23:4, he said we're walking through the valley of death. Again, that's not our destination, so don't be afraid. Going forward from the cross, every day of our lives is held securely in God's hands. Jesus already invaded and touched death for us. That's what the Bible says. That's what this week is about. When we truly say Y2J, yes to Jesus, the future has been secured. Our last breath here means that our next breath, or we'll be drawing our first breath in heaven in the presence of Jesus. Eternal death can no longer touch us because it already touched him. I mean, he took the hit for us. Do you understand that? He took the bullet that should have been ours. He defeated death, hell, and the grave, the scripture says. All we must deal with is the shadow of death. I don't know about you. When I was a kid, I was sure scared of shadows. Was anybody else, or was I just a sissy? And in the dark, but a shadow never hurt me. Did it ever hurt you? F.B. Meyer, patriarch, wrote this: Christ met the substance, so we just encounter the shadow. In other words, Christ took it on himself, the real thing, so all we have is a shadow. He goes on, the monster is deprived of teeth and claws. The wasp, if you will, stung the good shepherd to death and left his stinger fixed in the cross where he died. Would you rather be hit by a car or a shadow? I mean, it may be a close call if you're close enough for a speeding car to get hit by the shadow, but I'd rather be hit by the shadow, wouldn't you? We don't have to be afraid of anything. On the cross, everything changed. Because Jesus dealt with our past, the future is significantly different. Look at me. And this is true for you no matter where you are today, no matter where you've been. No exceptions. And if you think you are, that's arrogance and that's reverse form of pride. You're not beyond his touch. Finally, because of the cross, our present is changing. That's why we use the phrase around here all the time. Loving God, loving people. What's that lead to? Living transformed. That's not past tense. That's present tense active. It's not just changed, but it's always changing. Jesus didn't die to just save us from something. Listen, in the present, he died to save us for something. He spared our lives for something. We're here for a purpose. Are you fulfilling it? You can't fulfill your purpose unless you come through the cross and say yes to Jesus. Only then can you begin to fulfill the purpose. That's the number one thing. He wants you to be his child. You're his beloved. There are so many things in this world that could take us out in the presence and if you're a Jesus person, if you're alive and have breath in your lungs. That comes from God. We sing about that. He has a plan and a purpose for you on this earth. He wants you to be about the Father's business like Jesus. He wants to love through us. He wants to touch. He wants to serve. He wants to impact all kinds of people. And sometimes it's as simple as I just said. It's just being an inviting person. I mean, follow me as I follow Christ. Your life is so radiant, your testimony. But it's saying, come with me. Not go there, but come with me. Would you come with me? Would you join me? Could we walk together? That changes everything. By doing this, we are participating in this active step of plundering hell and populating heaven right now. Second Corinthians 5 from the Message paraphrase. It's a pastor's paraphrase, not a translation. God put the world square with himself through the Messiah, giving the world a fresh start by offering forgiveness of sins. God has given us the task of telling everyone what he's doing. We've been born and chosen for such a time as this. There's no accident. We're alive in these historic times, unprecedented times. We're to let the world know by the way we live and what we share that there's life and forgiveness and peace through Jesus. There's a relationship with God that changes everything, including the past and the future. God did it all through the cross, and now we are the good news delivery system, if you will. We're to be gospel mail carriers, gospel Amazoners, or whatever. That may be sacrilegious to tie those things two together. It's now our distinct privilege and responsibility to carry and express God's love faithfully in whatever platforms of influence he gives us, because here is holy. Not there, not where you were, where you're going to be, but right now. And I guarantee you, if you offer him the present right now, he'll take care of the future too. Here. Are you about the Father's business? I didn't say, were you? Are you? How are you serving him? How are you impacting the lives of others? Well, platforms are huge, and we think of platforms like, but sometimes platforms, I mean, any place that God have you, the talents and gifts, that's a platform that he wants to use to bring honor and glory to his name, whatever. The enemy, ending it, thought he had won, but he was dead wrong. He was, listen to this, he was actually used by God to help set up and bring about the salvation of the world. He thought Jesus was his prisoner, but Jesus reversed everything, and he was the one who ended up captive. And that's what we read in Colossians 13 and 14, that he disarmed the spiritual rulers and authorities. He shamed them publicly by his victory over them on the cross. Another one, a translation, New King James says, having disarmed principalities and powers, he made them a public spectacle, triumphing over them in it. That's exactly what he did. We don't have time to go into it, but I mean, basically, Jesus took a victory lap when he came out of the tomb. Did you know that? He didn't just ascend to heaven. He descended into the lowest place, and he took captives, and he disarmed forever the principalities and powers that would come against us. I mean, they may rage, but he has won it. He has won the victory. He made a public spectacle of them. That's just based on the Roman culture. They were alluding to the rider because the conquering general would come from afar, some glorious victory, and they would have a victory parade in the capital city, and the soldiers would come with pomp and circumstances, marching, springing their arms, and then the general and his chariot would come, and people were shouting his name and cheering, and behind them, and they said, actually, the front words were changed, that the prisoners of war, including the officers, they were dragged behind, and the people were shouting and cheering, you've overcome, you've won, you've conquered the enemy. Jesus made that a reality. In a moment on the cross, everything changed. We can read things from history, and I love history, and I think we need to read it and be aware of it so we never forget the amazing things that God did. But anything that happened on this earth in an instant pales when compared to what Jesus did in a moment when he gave up his breath on the cross and died. but I'll just give you an example. I'm fixated on history, and I read and went back to the story of the Battle of Midway. Has anybody heard that in the Pacific Theater in World War II? We had fronts, multiple fronts going, and that was there. And it started with Pearl Harbor, which was a disaster I think it was December 7th, 1941, if I'm not mistaken. Horrible disaster. And after that, most of our Pacific fleet was destroyed. So many, you know, if you've ever been to Pearl Harbor, as I have, we have, it's a reverent place where bodies are still entombed. But because our carriers we had three carriers that were out on maneuvers, they were not in Pearl Harbor. The Japanese Imperial Army was going to attempt what they'd finished it, what they'd started on that sleepy Sunday morning in December. And they knew that probably another surprise attack, because those carriers had gone back to Pearl Harbor, and they figured they had to do something to lure them out of the harbor, to get them out in the open where they could take them out. So they thought that they would try to lure them out, because they would attack Midway, because that was I think that they said it's about 2,000-acre island that was only about 1,000 or so miles from Hawaii. And I mean, they wanted to establish an airfield there, and they would have easy access. So they thought as they begin a bombardment, that would lure our carriers out, and they would go to the island, and then they were going to have battleships off to the side, and they were going to lure them into trap, ambush them, and they were going to destroy them. And remember again, at the beginning of World War II, our military power was not what it is. It was later. I mean, there were other world powers ahead of us. I mean, they had, after Pearl Harbor, they had 10 aircraft carriers to our 3, and they had 9 battleships, and we had 0. And their weaponry was so much more advanced than ours. So the plan was, again, to lure our carriers to Midway Island to intervene. Because we couldn't allow them to put that strategic runway in there. But somehow, we were able to discover their plan. And we actually got there, our carriers, before they did. We were greatly outgunned and outnumbered, but we surprised them, even yet. And even though we had that element of surprise on our side, things didn't go well at first, because our torpedo planes, the package they dropped, failed to make successful contact. A lot of them didn't explode. They missed their target with the enemy, and it looked like we were going to lose again. Things were going horribly. We were losing plane after plane. And even as their carriers then begin to launch fighters. But here's what happened. Some of the greatest generation, as has also been called, of brave fighter pilots, took it on themselves, and they began dive bombing these carriers. And they went into deep, dead dives and dropped their bombs at the last second, and then pulled up and away, and they hit the runways and the takeoff points of some of those huge ships. And within a span of the Bible, the history tells us, the books tell us, in a span of 5 minutes, we were able to disable and disarm and destroy nearly all of their carriers, turn the tide of momentum in the whole Pacific theater. In 5 minutes, literally, they said between 10:25 and 10:30, everything changed. We went from losing to winning. I mean, that's a moment in time. You know why it happened? History tells us that there was a brilliant man who had been a code breaker for years, and he would not give up. And due to his diligence, he was able to intercept and interpret enough of the codes to determine their plans for Midway. And we were able to get there first and surprise them. This gave us at least a fighting chance. The code was broken. Finally, I had never read this before, that there was a rainbow. Our bombers were desperately searching for their surprise battleship group lying in ambush, floating somewhere safely out there, out of harm's way, in hundreds of miles of ocean. It was worse than looking for a needle in the haystack. And they were running, desperately running low on fuel, and thought they were going to splash their planes into the sea. But when they were about to give up the search and turn back, a distant rainbow caught the eye of one of our bomber pilots. He radioed, and that rainbow he saw was caused by the sun glinting off the water behind a wake of one of those huge ships was kicking up, and a rainbow was in the sky. And sighting the rainbow caused our bombers to turn around, pursue and attack these ships successfully. They sacrificially, as I mentioned, began to dive and to bomb with great risk and at a possibility of great loss. They were able to take out that group of battleships and aircraft carriers. A code was broken and a rainbow of promise was seen. Everything changed how in 5 minutes. And if man could do that in a temporal victory, how much more did God do through Jesus on the cross when he breathed his last? He said, everything's changed. Where there was death, there's life. Where there was hopelessness and despair, there is hope forever. All because Jesus died on the cross. What have you done with that? Have you received it? When Jesus died on the cross in a moment, the code hanging over our heads was that was keeping us separated from God, that thing that was unbreakable seemingly. We couldn't, but he did it. He broke it. Jesus paid the price, and we no longer are at war with God, no longer dead in our sins and trespasses. There's peace, and now we're sent forth to share the hope, to live the hope. Yes, 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 with Easter impact, everything changed. Our past has changed. Our future is altered. Our present is constantly changing, being made new. Forgiveness and salvation is possible because of Jesus. I would be so heartbroken to know that there's people that came to Wooster Naz week after week after month after year, and they knew, we believe, we try to preach it as straight as we can according to God's word, but had never opened their heart and embraced and received what Jesus did for you. This is the one-on-one thing. This is about where you are. Have you received what Jesus did on the cross? Have you allowed him to deal with your past? Have you surrendered your future? Are you living in the present? Palms up. I'm going to invite you to stand as we conclude today. Everything changed in a moment on the cross. Yes, we're mourning. We're grieving the death of Jesus. Trying to empathize with those who were there, but we know it's going to end in victory because we have the view from this side of the cross. So just in the quietness of these closing moments, would you just let the Holy Spirit talk to you? And whether you understand that or not, he just has a way with our conscience inside just dealing with us. And I wonder if there's any that would just decide to go palms up and say, yes, Jesus, I hear it. I mean, this was factually observed by hundreds and hundreds of people. It's a fact. It's not fiction. Jesus is alive. But he died on the cross, and that's what we're remembering today to make it possible for me to be free of all my past, my sin. And so maybe where you are right now, maybe you're at home, maybe you're somewhere in this room, you just say, I'm going palms up. Jesus, I give you my sin. Can't fix myself. Can't figure it out. Can't break that code. Only you can. It's such a tangled mess. I've made a mess of it by my free will choice and by the things done to me, the things I've done. So I say, Jesus, I surrender those to you. I'm so sorry. I don't want to trust in myself. I want to trust in you. I want to surrender me to you right now. I give you my sin. I give you myself. I want to be known as a child of God. I want that to be my identity. I want to live that. I want to lean into it. I want to share that. I want to be about the Father's business in the present, not crippled by the past. But I want to live for his purposes in this holy moment where he has me. So Jesus, I say yes to you right now. I receive you by faith. I believe in you. I'm going to live for you. I'm going to trust you to straighten out all the messes I've made of my life, to break through those confusing things, that all the doubt. And I pray, Jesus, that you would make yourself real this week. And may we come back next Sunday with our hearts and minds poised for a celebration that Jesus came out of the tomb, sealing the victory once and for all. And I pray it thankfully in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen, 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 amen. Would you, between now and next Sunday, invite somebody for Good Friday Night Worship. Invite somebody, bring somebody with you next Sunday, and let's just have a glorious celebration of the risen Christ. And everybody said, amen, thank you. You're dismissed. Could you have something you can sing us on our way just a little bit? Take time, linger. I love the lingering effect here. Greet people, look for people you haven't spoken to. I haven't been able to greet you, I would love to do so. I'm going to make my way back to the foyer.
I hear the Savior say, thy strength in me.